Recorded Books and RB Digital present Theater of Spies by S.M. Stirling. Narrated by Todd McLaren. Prologue. Washington, D.C. Iron House. Consolidated War Department, Navy Department Headquarters. Situation and Maps Room. November 6th, A.D. 1916. 1916 B. Point of departure, plus 4 years. President Theodore Roosevelt stood with his feet braced and one hand gripping the lapel of his morning jacket, the other thrust into a pocket and clenched into a fist, looking at the maps that showed the great war's fronts and alliances and disasters, scowling through his pince-nez and his mustache bristling. It was an expression as formidable as his more famous tooth-bearing fighting grin. Officers of the Army, Navy, and Marine Corps, and a few from the Coast Guard, bustled quietly amid the clack of keys and murmur of telephones, updating the maps on the walls, or directing the whack girls in their crisp uniforms, who used long pool cue-like sticks to push markers on the big horizontal map tables that showed the movements of friendly and enemy units, and who manned, or perhaps staffed is the right word, he thought, the coding machines and teletypes that linked the room to the far-flung legions of the Republic. The thought came with a relief of a brief moment's whimsy as he gave a fond, proud glance at their patriotic, youthful earnestness. And if they were doing soldiers' work, why shouldn't they be in uniform? Albeit with skirts a mildly shocking 3 inches above the ankle, and get the same pay and ranks. He'd plucked Helen Varick Boswell from the women's bureau of the party to organize the Women's Auxiliary Corps for the Army. And anyone who didn't like her being General Boswell now could just go and do that other thing. Roosevelt and his aides and personal secretary and Secret Service bodyguards attracted a few glances, despite the disciplined intensity of the work. It suddenly occurred to him that the national vote would be tomorrow, and that he hadn't thought about it in days, which must be a first for a president standing for re-election, much less for a unique fourth term.
Fourth, if you count taking over for McKinley after the assassination in 01, which I do, since the amiable old duffer had all the backbone of a chocolate eclair and never actually did anything in all his born days, bless him. Not without a push, usually, from me.
Against his usual custom, this time he hadn't even ridden a special train from city to city and town to town, giving whistle-stop speeches to impromptu crowds. Events had kept him pinned to Washington.
Not that it matters. The result's even more of a foregone conclusion than it was in 1912. And that was never in doubt after poor Taft's heart attack. How long ago that seems.
A horrible thought occurred to him.
God have mercy on us. If Taft had lived, Woodrow Woodenhead Wilson might be president now and facing this.
He shook his head as if to shed the image, though the news was bad enough to inspire any number of morbid fantasies. God, or fate, or destiny, had spared the United States that, at least. He'd swept back into office on an unprecedented wave of support, the strongest mandate since George Washington's, a vote for his plans to seize the dawning century for America and the new nationalism. One of the things he'd done since was take the nation by the scruff and make it face up to the fact that it was a dangerous world now, and that you had to be prepared.
Getting elected is only important because of what you do once you are. These maps are more important than electioneering.
There were three on the section of the wall he was staring at, showing Paris, London, and Bordeaux, where the top echelon of the French government had retreated after the first airborne gas attack on Paris in May, which had seemed so terrible at the time, but had only contained conventional phosgene, and only killed thousands. All three maps had broad, shaded marks on them, shaped roughly like an overlapping series of blobby, elongated teardrops. That showed where the Germans' super Zeppelin bombers had dropped 50 to 100 tons of the Vernichtungsgas on each city. The enemy were calling it that, annihilation gas, though he preferred the popular coinage of horror gas. The scientists termed it organomethylphosphonathioate nerve agent X, and claimed it wasn't even a gas at normal temperatures, strictly speaking. And more importantly, they'd found that a single liter of it, 2 pints, held 1 million lethal doses if perfectly distributed. The half-ton canisters of horror gas had burst at 1,000 feet, or sometimes wherever burning airships had exploded under attack by fighting scout aeroplanes. Then, the winds had carried the finely divided aerosol of drops over square miles of city as they settled. Most of the Zeppelins had died over their targets or crashed on their way back, but they had taken 3 cities with them. Below the maps were slots where estimates from military intelligence and the Black Chamber, and the Allied governments, or what was left of them, were updated daily. Paris and London each showed over 600,000 dead and climbing fast. Bordeaux much less, but if anything, a higher proportion of its smaller population. Nobody had any idea how many more civilians had been crippled or driven mad by marginal doses on the fringes of the killing zones. The gas was so persistent, especially in cold weather or sheltered spots or soaked into skin and cloth and hair and wood, that you couldn't go near the contaminated areas except in something like a deep-sea diver's rubber suit.
And nobody has any idea of how many have just run for their lives and are starving in ditches. The Kaiser's plot, or Hindenburg or Ludendorff's plot, cut the heads off 2 great nations at a stroke, he thought with throttled rage, and came within a hair of wrecking us if the chamber hadn't stopped it. When we win this war, everyone involved will hang.
One of his military aides cleared his throat and took a brief glance at his newfangled wristwatch. Roosevelt nodded brusquely and followed horse-faced young Bradley's jug ears down an arch-roofed corridor toward the meeting room. 2 motionless Marine guards with Thompson guns on assault slings across their bellies and faces like carved wood under their turtle-shaped steel helmets flanked the door, snapping to attention for an instant and then returning to their watchfulness. The president walked past them and sat at the head of the big oval table, nodding to the respectful greetings and salutes. There was a general rustle as files were opened and pads made ready. There were maps here, too, set up on easels or hanging before the walls, mostly of Europe and North Africa, some of Asia.
And none showing the things I wanted to see.
With the chiefs of staff was Director Wilkie, head of the Secret Service, and more importantly of the, until recently, officially non-existent subsection that had grown to utterly overshadow it, the Black Chamber, whose motto was Ex umbris acies, from the shadows, steal.
Though they think I don't know that the unofficial chamber motto is Deodorum parvis concitaris ne perturbatus sit, which means, don't bother Teddy with the details. It'll just upset him. Right, gentlemen. We're here to appraise the general situation and make sure that we're all reading from the same page, as it were.
That phrase was his own coinage, and he thought it rather pithy.
And there are some political developments, integrating Canada, for instance, that will give you enough extra work to keep you from the temptations of idleness and dissipation.
He grinned at that, and they were tired chuckles. None of the men in the room looked as if they were getting enough sleep, and he knew he wasn't. He could barely squeeze in an hour or two a day, swimming and wrestling and working the punching bag.
"Tell me some bad news, Leonard," Roosevelt said to the head of the general staff. "Start with the bad, at least, and work your way up to the unthinkably terrible. We can do a world tour. It's a world war now that we're officially in it, at last."
"Mr. President, other resources may be short, but of bad news in all flavors, we can give you any amount," Leonard Wood said in his soft New England accent. His long, craggy Yankee face was professionally impassive, and his voice calm. But they'd been friends for decades, and had commanded the Rough Riders together. Roosevelt could tell grimness when it spoke. "Apart from the fact that the Mexican protectorate is finally quiet, fairly quiet, bad news is about all we have on the menu." Roosevelt's lips tightened beneath his bushy mustache as he listened to the catalog of disasters that followed. The United States had been forced into a war where Germany stood triumphant. From the ruins and chaos of Russia, through the mass flight of the French to North Africa, and on to the desperate heroism of the British rear guards, dying where they stood under hammerstorms of steel and poison fire to shelter the improvised evacuation from Dunkirk and Calais. That was an epic that might breed a legend for the future, but right now it was another defeat. It wasn't war as he'd known it as Colonel of the Rough Riders, or dreamed of even in nightmares. Nobody had but H.G. Wells, whose "The War in the Air" was starting to look horribly prophetic in this day of the breaking of nations. But there was no denying that it worked. His only consolation was that this time, for once in the history of the United States, he'd ensured that America was more or less ready for a fight at the start of a conflict. Against the Germans, there wasn't much margin for error or time to learn on the job. When the litany of blood and destruction was finished, Roosevelt set his palms on the reddish-brown Cuban mahogany of the table and spoke.
"Thank you, General Wood. There you have it, gentlemen. Our course is clear for the immediate future. There remains one matter of very serious import, which Director Wilkie and Admiral Sims will now outline."
Wilkie of the Black Chamber took his cue.
"The Imperial German Navy is making serious preparations to sortie sometime in the next few months. We have that by the reports of agents who saw Wilhelmshaven in person, and it's confirmed by our cryptographic work and that of the Royal Navy, which makes no sense, which means we're all missing something. Something crucial. Something that could bite us in a sensitive place."
Admiral Sims stroked his short-clipped, white-shot beard.
"Naval intelligence agrees. We and the Royal Navy together have overwhelming superiority, and the short days and bad weather at this time of the year mean that such an action would be a close-in slugging match, which adds to our advantage of numbers and weight of metal, and they can do the arithmetic, too. They have some ace up their sleeve. A surprise."
"The world has lost far too much to far too many German surprises already," Roosevelt agreed. "Director Wilkie, finding out what they have planned is now your absolute priority. If we lose control of the North Sea, Britain goes with it, and Berlin will rule everything from Iceland to the Urals. God may know how we'd come back from that, but I do not. Mr. President, we're on it."
The Black Chamber's director looked quietly confident. Everyone else in the room was looking at him with respect, at the least, shading up into hero worship from some of the younger officers. The details were deeply secret, but it was generally known that the Germans had tried to wreck the main American port cities on the Atlantic with horror gas attacks from specially built U-boats, even before the declaration of war. That would have slaughtered millions and killed any chance of thwarting the mad dream of a German-dominated world. But the Black Chamber had thoroughly thwarted it. Only the one in Savannah had struck, and there had been enough warning that the city had been evacuated first.
"I'm putting my best field operatives on it, Mr. President," Wilkie said.
Their eyes met. Roosevelt knew who he meant, and what the cost might be to someone who'd romped as a child with his own sons and daughters, whose father had gone up San Juan Hill with him, and whom he'd held as she wept over her murdered parents. His own four sons were in the army. Even young Quentin, who was only a lad of 19 and heedlessly eager to be a man. All the boys were in fighting units, including the new Air Corps, by their own wish, and doing well by their own merits. He feared for them every day, but it would have broken his heart if any of them had tried to avoid frontline service. Black Chamber operative Luz O'Malley and that charming, eccentric young Boston girl, Ciara Whelan, had saved the nation from the German horror gas plot with cold cunning and high courage. But a great nation needed a great deal of saving in this terrible new age, and they were willing and ready to run the risks again, risks worse than going over the top in the face of Maxim guns and mustard gas.
"We do not exist for ourselves alone. None of us do. That's why I went to Cuba, even though Edith was so very sick and our children so young, though I felt as if I were torn in two. We are the tools of something greater than any of us, and if the tool breaks beneath the strain, then another steps forward, and the greater purpose goes on. The lines of blood, and beyond that, the nation that is the embodiment and bloodline of all our people."
Roosevelt nodded to the Black Chamber's director, a slight crisp gesture to affirm his choice. Wilkie returned it and went on.
"My very best operatives, Mr. President, and there aren't any better in the world."
1. Casa de los Amantes, Santa Barbara, California, November 17, 1916, B.
"Now that was a strange and lovely dinner, my darling, and fine people,"
Ciara Whelan said dreamily from behind the wheel of the auto.
"Though it's good to be home, too. Glad you enjoyed yourself, Carita,"
Black Chamber operative Luz O'Malley Rostegui said over her shoulder as she swung the wrought iron gates closed behind them and shot the bolt with a clank.
"And speaking of joy, it's finally here," she thought, as she fished a small package out of the mailbox built into the thickness of the wall beside the gate and slipped it into the pocket of her skirt.
"I had fun too,"
she added sincerely. Warm sake was insidious, but neither of them was more than slightly elevated and very pleasantly satisfied, but not full. Their hosts had laid on the full seven-course splendor of a kaiseki ryori, but Japanese cooking at that level hewed to an austere and elegant restraint. The Taguchis couldn't have afforded a feast like that back in Hiroshima Prefecture. Mrs. Taguchi had learned the art working as an assistant cook at a ryokan inn, and her husband had been the fourth son on a little peasant farm. But they'd done very well for themselves here with their nursery, gardening, landscaping business after years of toil and grit and thrift.
"And the hair glued across the lock wasn't broken?"
Ciara asked.
"Intact," Luz said.
She'd set three, at the gate, at the front door, and on the light switch just inside it, and she'd been conscious of the FM automatic in her jacket and the 6-inch Navaja, her folding knife, in its special pocket in her skirt as she checked the marker just now. The likelihood of some surviving Mexican revolucionario or an inquisitive Abteilung 3B agent finding out where a Black Chamber operative lived was quite low. But low wasn't zero, and she didn't intend to die of stupid.
If they're all still in place, it's pretty certain no one came through the gate or the front door, she continued. Two intact would be suspicious. One would be very suspicious. And three gone definitely means enemy action.
Ciara nodded. She was picking up tradecraft on the job the way most in the chamber did, though she'd torn through the manuals with ferocious concentration. There were regular training courses now, but still not enough time to put everyone through them first. She'd already noted how all the exterior doors and windows in Luz's home could be fastened from the inside with unpickable bolts.
"But you've got to be careful with the spirit gum, or it's obvious," Luz went on. "Just a touch on your pinky from the tinfoil tube when you apply it. Or better still, draw the hair through it. The main problem is that even a hair-fine hair is visible on a pale surface, and mine's black, so it shows up worse even in low light. Sometimes I carry a spool of light-colored thread. Or I could just pull out one of yours now, I suppose, sweetie. Warn me first, so I don't give us away by shrieking," Ciara chuckled.
Then she frowned. It was the expression Luz had come to know meant she was deep in something technical and about to display the fruits of natural talent and a lifelong project of self-education, though that life had seen barely 21 years so far.
"Witness her happy squeals going through Papa's old project plans. Every time she says, 'Oh, Luz, this is so clever,' or 'Your da did this so elegantly,' that makes me feel proud of Papa and her all over again. You know, I could do a hidden counting system, adapting a factory punch clock, maybe, for all the gates and doors and windows," Ciara said, "and a master switch to set it all going when you left."
"Excellente," Luz said.
Probably we could get the chamber to pay for it, too. And the design would look good in your record jacket, Junior Field Operative Whelan. Very progressive."
She leaned into the driver's side for a brief, soft kiss that tasted of sake and ginger-infused pear, walked around the hood, laid a hand on the side, and swung into the passenger seat with a lithe hop. The low-slung, open-top coal 440 Roadster slid forward with a burble of throttle-down engine and a pop and crunch of gravel beneath the wheels. The electric headlamps cut two yellow tunnels in the darkness, showing white crushed stone, and now and then the flutter of a pink tiger moth or a glimpse through groves and gardens.
"And how kind it was of the Taguchis to invite us both to dinner," Ciara added. "I thought it was about time to introduce you to some family friends, mi amor. And the Taguchis are about the oldest friends my parents had in Santa Barbara."
She thought Kira's nod and smile in return had an element of relief. They'd been together just long enough to start thinking seriously about the future, and being madly in love didn't mean you completely knew someone. Not when they'd only met in September. If you were smart, you realize that. And while Ciara was naive in some ways and had no natural talent for dealing with people,
"She is as smart as they come, and I'm relieved she's relieved."
Luz let her head fall against the back of her seat, and the pleasantly cool wind of Southern California's November night played through her bobbed, raven-black hair as they drove, looking up at the bright Pacific stars flickering through the leaves of the live oaks that lined the long, curving driveway. The air carried the scent of cut grass, flowers, and the sea, and the hiss of surf on the beach southward was just audible. It took a little time to reach the Casa de los Amantes, as the yellow stucco walls and Roman tile roof loomed through the trees. It wasn't particularly large by the standards of Montecito, as this neighborhood was known, but the grounds were big, with small groves of oranges and olives, figs and peaches, and a little vineyard around a big kitchen garden, as well as lawns and flower beds between the winding paths, live oak and poplar and cypress, and scattered tall palms. Her father had taken this land as payment for his first big local commission. Here she'd played and roamed as a girl, amid brightly colored dreams of adventure and formless longings for she knew not what.
"Enjoy every moment,"
Luz thought, with a mixture of pleasure and sadness.
"The Great War isn't going to leave us alone forever."
She was a little surprised the director had waited this long to throw them back into the stew pot.
"Which means I can't wait any longer to say what I'm planning on saying. But am I reluctant for scruple's sake? She is very young. Or is it sheer cowardice that's giving me palpitations? Scruples were never something I was afflicted with before, any more than I was with pimples. But I've never been in love before either. Not like this. It's been a while since I went to a family dinner party,"
Ciara added. And then, in a voice less happy as her hands clenched on the wheel,
"Not since I let that foolish, wicked man Sean McDuffie talk me into going to Germany for him like a fool myself, and believed him when he said that it was for Ireland."
Ciara had wanted to do something dreadful to the British, to avenge the brother who died on the barricades in Dublin in the Easter Rising. Though not enough to go along when she realized how dreadful the plan was, or that it was meant for America, too.
"I'm glad you did go to Germany, or we'd never have met," Luz said. "And it was revenge on Villa and his men for my Mima and Papa that sent me into the chamber."
Aloud, she went on.
"Also, I'd have been dead without you to confirm my cover to Colonel Nikolai and warn me about his alarm system before I went in to crack his files. Dead and very lonely, if that makes any sense. Everyone makes mistakes. It's turning them around that's important. And you certainly did that."
Ciara laughed, and Luz could see her shoulders relax in the dim light. She brought the two-seat roadster to a halt in the converted carriage house with skilled panache, hardly needing to use the brake at all, though she'd never even been a passenger in an auto before she left Boston a few months ago as a clandestine courier for the Irish Republican Brotherhood. Going straight from the violently illegal IRB to the Black Chamber, jocularly known in government and party circles as El Jefe's Brass Nux, was a first, too. But then, the chamber prided itself on putting function ahead of formality, and its ever-growing roles were full of adventurers, eccentrics, buccaneering soldiers of fortune, genteel university-educated thugs, old cowboy rough riders, the odd Indian, and the just plain odd, like one Luz O'Malley Arrostigui. Sometimes the borderline mad, like the head of the technical section, Nikolai Tesla. Hot metal ticked in the engine as they picked up the coats they might have needed on a Santa Barbara November night, but hadn't, and walked back to the house hand in hand and up the four semicircular steps of white limestone to the front door, breathing in the scent of the banks of purple-blossomed Mexicali rose planted around the cream stucco walls. Then she unlocked the solid outer doors, twin arched leaves of carved oak set with pyramidal iron studs, and checked that the hair was in place across the inward swinging inner doors of wrought iron and hammered brass in the shape of peacocks. They had the 16-room building to themselves. Luz hadn't kept any live-in staff since she pensioned off the last old retainers when she went into the chamber. A cleaning and maintenance service did well enough when she was away so much, and was easy to get in this area of vacation homes. Taguchi Gardens saw to the grounds.
"And the front door and light switch markers are intact too," she said,
swinging the doors shut behind them, locking them, and turning on the lights. The chandelier high overhead glowed, turning cavernous gloom to brightness.
Aye, that flower scent always takes me back to my childhood. Mima planted those right after Papa built the first part of this house for her, the south wing. They reminded her of her home in Cuba. Though hopefully not of how her own father tried to have them both killed the night they eloped,
she added to herself. She told Ciara about that, but few others. Ciara nodded, then returned to her thought.
I didn't know if we could do that. You know, visit with people together. As a couple? With discretion, yes, and depending on the circles you move in, Luz said. More discretion with some people than others, of course, and absolute discretion with many, alas for the world's idiocy. But even people who disapprove in theory will often make an exception for you in practice if they know and like you as an individual. Consistency is for fanatics, after all. Your aunties did well enough in South Boston, didn't they? Well, yes, bless them. Bless them indeed, Luz thought.
Not for the first time, either. Without Ciara's Aunt Colleen and her life companion, honorary Auntie Trinell, and their good example, things would have been
much more complicated. Yes, they're very well liked in the neighborhood, for that they've always been ready to lend a hand when there's bad luck or strong need. Marketing done, or a meal cooked for someone who has to sit up with a sick child. Letters written, or accounts cast up for those who haven't the knack. Help at a wedding or funeral. Things like that. So there's a smile and nod, and many a stop to pass on gossip when they pass by. But nobody knew that they were...
Ciara stopped, thought for a moment, then went on.
No, I think... Looking back and knowing what I know now, I think a lot of people did know about Auntie Colleen and Auntie Trinell, or suspected. But they just didn't say anything where I could hear it. So I didn't realize it myself until I started thinking about how I felt about you. And it all went click in my head, even though they raised me in Colne nearly as much as Da did. To be sure, someone said Boston marriage once, but that's... ambiguous, Luz said. Though not as ambiguous as it was in our parents' time. Still, it's not what people know is true that's usually important. It's what they'll pretend to believe is true by unspoken mutual consent, because it's easier all round. Did the Toguchis,
Ciara said,
know we were lovers? Well, nothing was said aloud on either side. But I'm pretty sure they did. I'm absolutely sure that Fumiko and Midori did. We were like sisters as little girls, and we're still very good friends and keep in touch. And from the smiles and nods and thumbs up they gave when nobody was looking, I know they thoroughly liked you. They'd have been polite to you even if they hadn't, but... And I appreciate the gesture,
Luz thought fondly, as Ciara gave her a glowing grin that lit her turquoise eyes and snub-nosed, freckled, round face for a moment.
The whole Taguchi family always did have exquisite manners. Dios los bendiga.
Luz grinned herself and trailed her fingers on the balustrade as they linked hands and walked slowly up the curving stairs to the second-story landing, their footsteps going click on the iron-hard, black-streaked maroon kurupai wood of the risers, louder for the silence of the house.
When I was a little girl, I used to love to slide down the banister here. Mima scolded me. Ay, menina, pero que chamaca más traviesa eres, she'd say. But her heart wasn't in it, and Papa smiled. Sometimes he'd do it himself, with me in his lap. He always liked it when I did things like that, or climbed trees, or rode my pony fast. It's quite the tomboy you were then, and you so smooth and elegant a lady now.
No reason you can't like both. It depends on the circumstances. Once, when I was 8, and Tommy Devereaux yanked on my pigtails from behind in class hard enough to make my eyes show tears. And not for the first time, I might add. The miserable bully,
Ciara said sympathetically. There weren't many schoolgirls who hadn't had that experience.
I hope someone gave him a taste of his own medicine someday.
Luz grinned.
When Luz O'Malley turned around and gave him a black eye then and there. And he punched me back, and we went tumbling around the floor, knocking things over, and screeching and bellowing. Well, I screeched. He tried to bellow, and he was built like a little blonde bullock. But at 8...
Ciara stopped and clapped her hands in delight.
And how did that end? With me sitting on his chest, barking my knuckles on his face, and screaming like a banshee, while he bawled for mercy and his mother. Until the teacher pushed through and pulled me off and carried me bodily out of the room in a hissing fury, wiggling and kicking like a mad ferret. And then they sent for my father. This was back right after the war with Spain started, just before he left for the Rough Rider camp in Texas with a telegram from Uncle Teddy in his hand, telling him to make haste if he wanted a commission.
Ciara winced.
Oh, I hope he wasn't too angry.
Luz shook her head, a fond expression on her face.
Papa? He came into the principal's office with the teacher pouring the tale of it in his ear, and saw me sitting and pouting with my blouse ripped, my hair like a haystack, and my face like a thundercloud. And Tommy whimpering through a cloth full of ice on the other side of the room. I can see it as if I were there. He wasn't angry. He laughed and said, Well, and here's the tail end of a shindy I'd have paid good money to see, and no mistake, eh? And your father wouldn't by any chance have had the blood of Erin's warriors in his veins, would he, Miss O'Malley? Oh, perhaps so un poco. More, tell me what happened next.
Luz chuckled. They were still at the stage where they were trying to swallow each other's pasts at a gulp. She marshaled her memories.
He came over and felt my hands gently. They were all bloody and skinned in places, and the left one had started to swell. I winced a bit because I'd popped the knuckle. You can feel it here. See, the second on the left hand? It's still a little bigger. Oh, you poor thing, Ciara said, and kissed it. That must have hurt.
Luz chuckled agreement and touched the finger to Kira's snubbed nose.
By then, it hurt like it was dipped in fire, and the memories yet green. Papa's eyebrows went up as he felt it. He knew Brawler's injuries. Well, he'd been bossing countryside construction projects for years. Rough men. Rough men. Away from home. Many with no family and good reason to keep moving from job to job. And a love of the jug. So, that meant thumping beefy, quarrelsome drunks now and then to teach them respect. Or helping patch up enough of them on Sunday morning to get the project going again come dawn on Monday. And he said, We'll need some ice over here too, please. And I think a strip of bandage and a sling. Does it hurt when I touch the knuckle here, Astorin, my darling little treasure?
Luz smiled at the memory of his face.
I said, A bit, Papa, just since I stopped. It didn't hurt right away?
Ciara asked curiously.
No. No, when you're in a fight, you're transported, changed, taken beyond the everyday. So things like that don't matter. It's like sharing love, or like flying in dreams. At least it is for me, sometimes. And he whistled and said, You kept right on punching him hard as you could with that, didn't you, my little Miss Spitfire O'Malley? To which I replied, It didn't hurt when I was hitting him, Papa. I was too busy.
Ciara snorted at that. and Luz squeezed her hand as she continued.
Then he whistled again and shook his head when he put my hands down, gently, and said, as if to himself or to Mima, Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, but we've bred us a wild one, Luciana darling. And then to me, your mother will have a word or two to say when she sees you. And what did you have to say to that?
Ciara asked.
It would have had me quaking, I'll tell you. I said with a smugness only an 8-year-old could muster, that Tommy's mother would cry when she saw him. Did she? Like a gardener's watering can, only much louder. Papa looked over, and they'd just taken down the cloth with the ice so the nurse could have a look at Tommy. She was clucking, but luckily not finding anything that wouldn't heal. And he whistled again and said, Faith, his face looks like the beefsteak he'll be putting on that fine shiner you gave him. And I smiled, though that hurt too. I had a split lip dribbling down my chin under my blouse, and I said, Well, that'll teach him to pull on an O'Malley's braids.
Ciara gave a peal of delighted laughter.
Good for you, and good for your da, she said. A fine man he was. And was it all worth the switching you got from the principal? Absolutely worth sitting down carefully for a while. Doubly so when Tommy got the cane, too, for starting it, and he walked out of the principal's office blubbing, and I didn't. Oh, foolish of him, knowing children.
Luce's cat-like expression was one Tommy Devereux would have recognized and flinched from.
The other boys would go boo-hoo at him on the playground, and the girls whispered behind their hands and giggled. And he'd turn red as a boiled beet every time. It was wonderful. And he never pulled another girl's braids. That sounds like you, my heart,
Ciara said.
Now, sneaking out of bed to read at night was my naughtiness, if I couldn't bear to stop where I was in the story.
Luz smiled and leaned over to kiss the top of her head.
Why am I not surprised? Raised in a bookstore, Ciara Whelan was. The sorrow and pity of it. Oh, don't throw me in the briar patch, Briar Fox. So, you burned the midnight oil, eh?
Ciara stuck her tongue out before she continued.
Downstairs in the shop with a street lamp came through the window, and I'd sit wrapped in the quilt in the big armchair. Da said I'd ruin my eyes and stunt my growth when he caught me at it, or saw me yawning too much at breakfast. But he never gave me more than a little smack on the fanny, and sometimes he'd come and read me a bit before I fell asleep. The Field of Bullions, or The Children of Lear. He never did take the bell to comb much, either, for all that he was wild enough as a boy. I think he saw our ma in us. From her picture, she looked a little like me, and I inherited her hair.
She touched her piled locks, a yellow halfway to copper red.
Da's was brown.
She sighed. Her mother had died of childbed fever not long after she was born. Then her white, slightly irregular teeth showed in a broad grin full of crackly energy as they came to the top of the stairs. She tugged at Luce's hand and said,
Let's go swim.
That was another thing Ciara had never had much chance to do in Boston, and had taken to with enormous enthusiasm here. They helped each other unhook their semi-formal afternoon dresses when they reached the master bedroom. You didn't do an evening gown for a small family dinner party, nor at the O'Malley to Gucci level of society, and not in these more casual, modern times. It was a much less complicated process than it would have been a few years ago, as well as being... Luz leaned forward and whispered in Kira's ear.
It's Christmas early this year, and I'm unwrapping the world's most beautiful present.
Then she kissed her between the shoulder blades.
A happy, Oh, you!
In reply came with a poke in the ribs, and
These dresses, they're so comfortable.
Women's clothing had changed drastically, even in the 5 years since she was Kira's age, and in ways she heartily approved. Coco Chanel's latest continued the trend.
But hobble skirts. Hobble skirts were an evil plot against half the human race.
They hung the clothes and tossed the underthings in a hamper in the walk-in cupboard. Then, Luz stretched on tiptoe with her fingers linked above her head, before going down on one knee to light the paper and kindling fire set beneath stacked driftwood, ready in the bedroom's hearth.
We'll want this blazing when we're through in the pool, even if my love is part polar bear.
She felt Kira's eyes on her as she tossed the splint into the flames and winked.
It's not fair,
Kira laughed, putting her hands on her hips.
You can put me to the blush so much more easily than I can you.
That was true enough, even discounting experience, since Luz's complexion was a clear olive that tanned readily to a warm, light, honey golden brown. She took after her mother that way, along with full lips and high cheekbones, though the narrow blue streaks near the pupils of her dark eyes were her father's, and so was her long-limbed build. Hair, the almost iridescent black of a raven's wing, could have been from either. By contrast, Kira's skin had a translucent paleness that showed blue traceries of vein and didn't take the sun at all. She was also fuller figure than Luz's leopardess build, 2 inches shorter at 5'4", but weighing about the same. She did blush now at Luz's frank appreciation, a flush spreading down from face to bosom.
So, swim, she said, extending a hand.
Half an hour later, Luz was glad of the loose jalabas of striped wool she and Ciara were both wearing as they climbed back to the terrace outside the bedchamber. A friend had brought a dozen of them back from a mission in Oran in French North Africa and given them to her last Christmas. And they were amazingly, softly comfortable, one size fits all, and just warm enough.
I'm glad I got Julie something nice for this Christmas, Luz thought,
distracted for an instant, or perhaps taking refuge in an irrelevant thought.
She and Bob will love those matching Purdy 338 side-by-sides, and there won't be any more since Purdy and Sons had their shop right in Mayfair.
Ciara didn't notice cold nearly as much, but then this was fine June weather by Massachusetts standards. Perhaps she felt the chill in Luz's fingers.
There's that lovely alpaca skin rug before the fire, she said as they came to the top of the stairs,
her voice sweet with promise.
That would be all toasty by now for my delicate hibiscus blossom beloved. Una inspiración maravillosa. But wait just a moment, my heart, mi amor, Luz said. And my goosebumps aren't all from the chill,
she thought before continuing aloud.
There's something worth seeing from here.
They stood by the railing, arms around each other's waists, and Kira's head on her shoulder. Luz leaned her own cheek against her lover's damp locks, looking out from the terrace toward the blue-black line of the ocean just west of due south from here. The sky was cloudless and a blaze of stars from horizon to horizon. She'd switched off the exterior lights, and Santa Barbara was neither close enough nor large enough nor bright enough at nearly midnight to wash out the sky. The Milky Way reared in an arch of white diamond dust above them. Gibbous and hugely yellow gold, the moon hung over the waters to the south and east. A long path glittered from it over the foam-flecked waves, leading beyond the world. Ciara made a wordless sighing sound, and her arm tightened on Luz's waist.
Oh, thank you, my darling,
she said, watching the moon hang over the Pacific.
That is marvelous.
Luz swallowed. Her throat was a little dry and tight. She turned and faced Ciara. The younger woman's eyes searched hers gravely, matching the sudden seriousness she sensed.
Mi amor, mi corazón, these weeks together have been the happiest in my life. Not just fun, but happy. So happy, I feel very slightly guilty, feeling so absolutely happy amid the wreck of the world. But life goes on for people. It has to. And it would do nobody good to sit and mope, po-faced. For me too, my darling one,
Ciara said earnestly.
I love you so much, and I want more of this. More than anything. I want you. For my very own, always. And I you, beloved,
Luz said. She reached into the pocket of her robe, and her fingers closed around the little box that had arrived while they were out.
If it weren't for the war, I might have waited a little. For your sake, my heart. So that we could have gotten to know each other better. More deeply. But we don't have all the time in the world before the world visits us again. And quite possibly kills us,
she thought, and knew the thought was shared.
Probably, even.
Ciara smiled a little.
If it weren't for the war, we wouldn't have met at all. I know how it says hurry, so don't keep me in suspense.
Luz braced herself and opened the box, setting it on the balustrade railing between them. Ciara gave a soft gasp. Within the velvet padding were two clada, Irish pledge rings, with bezels in the shape of two linked hands clasping across a crowned heart, done in gold, silver, diamonds, and ruby chips that glittered softly by the light of moon and stars. The form had been used among the Gael for centuries, in pledging loyalty or troth.
Ciara, will you stay with me and be my love?
Luz said, taking up one ring.
Shall we be comrades and partners through life?
A tear glistened at the corner of one of Kira's turquoise green eyes.
Yes, Luz. Oh, yes.
2. Casa de los Amantes, Santa Barbara, California, November 18th, 1916 B. Just afternoon the next day, the doorbell rang in a series of chimes as they sat over the remains of a very late breakfast in the patio courtyard. Luz and Ciara started, froze, looked at each other, and burst into laughter at the same moment.
Hold that thought,
Luz said as she rose from the big chair they'd been sharing while they fed each other spoonfuls of fresh berries and cream and the rest of their breakfast. As she walked through the arched door of the courtyard and into the entrance hall of the casa, she felt her armor slipping into place, a cold, cat-like awareness that radiated out like an invisible psychic shell. It had grown stronger every day since her parents died while she hid in the wardrobe a few feet away. The good thing was that now she knew she could take it off. By the time she'd reached the front door, Ciara was back, with a billhook from a storage closet, a heavy curved blade on a long pole used for trimming shrubbery, or inconvenient people, if you knew your medieval history. Luz gave her a quick smile of approval. She'd seen firsthand that her partner didn't lose her nerve in a tight place. Not that she expected to fight now, but you never knew. That was why she had the Browning automatic and her knife, the Andalusian Navaja, in her pockets, which was something of a judgment on the life that fate or her own choices had handed her. But you couldn't run things back and see how they might have turned out differently.
Glad to have you with me, querida,
But let's not terrify an innocent delivery man too much as he stands outside with a box of oysters on ice, see? People might talk.
Ciara nodded and put the billhook behind a tall ornamental vase, where she could lunge for it if she had to. Then she stepped sideways and glanced through the edge of one of the big grillwork barred windows that flanked the entrance.
It isn't a delivery man. Unless Deal's Grocery has gotten a canary yellow Cadillac Type 53 Roadster with black trim to replace their Model T truck since last week. Very nice. The one with their high-compression 77-horsepower V8 engine. It's probably as fast as your lovely, lovely Cole 440.
Luz used the fisheye lens concealed in one of the door studs. The man outside was 3 years older than her 25 and wore a lightweight sack suit and matching waistcoat of a pale, fawn, sharkskin silk worsted mixture, beautifully cut to conceal the shoulder holster under his armpit and the stiletto in a forearm sheath.
"It's someone I know, another senior field operative," she said,
and slid her hand out of her pocket, without the gun.
"Though, come to think of it, I outrank him now. Damn the man. But this is black chamber business. Hello, James," she added as she pulled the outer door open.
The chamber's discipline wasn't as obvious as the army's, but it was stronger, if anything. James Shiny had 6 slim feet of height and a long, bony face, with the weathered tan of an Anglo-Saxon who spent much time in the open air. A thin, 3-inch-long vertical scar marked his right cheek, and there was something very cruel about his blue-gray eyes and rather curved lips. A comma of hair, nearly as black as Luce's own Pallair-style bob, fell on his forehead.
"Do come in, briefly," Luz told him. "Mi casa no es su casa."
He doffed his gray Homburg politely, though he used the left hand that also held an attaché case in a practiced reflex that kept his right free at all times. Document courier was far below his usual pay grade, which meant it was something of the highest priority.
"Good to see you too, Luz," he said.
The case wasn't handcuffed to his wrist, but doing just that, put up a flag reading,
"Something you really want to see here. Kill me and cut it off."
The sort of thing you expected the Federal Bureau of Security or the Heinz 57 varieties of military intelligence to do.
"But perhaps it's better that way because they're mostly so dim. It might just slip their mind that they put that pesky case full of utterly secret documents down on the seat in the streetcar and then walked off and left it. Or should I say, executive field operator Luz, now?"
Like hers, his palm was hard, calloused, and dry as they shook hands.
"That's your exalted and most high mightiness, Imperatrice Omnipotente, Executive Field Operative O'Malley, ma'am, James," Luz said dryly. "But don't let your humble awe and the oppressive knowledge that you are as worms and dirt beneath my jeweled sandals make you overformal. And this charming young lady, your omnipotent Imperial Executive Highness," he said, inclining his head and smiling. "My friend Ciara Whelan, now a junior field operative herself," Luz said.
She pronounced it properly as Ciara, and with a slight sigh. The outside world was crashing back into weeks of golden dream.
"Ciara, this is senior field operative
Chiney," he said, accepting her brief, firm shake, too. "James Chiney."
"Pleased to make your acquaintance, Mr. Chiney," she said warily,
unconsciously stepping closer to Luz for reassurance.
"Enchanted, Miss Whelan. I'm very glad you're here, as my instructions from headquarters involve you, too. And what a lovely home," he added.
He looked around at the high, airy tile and plaster splendors of the hallway, and the double stairs curling upward toward the landing. Through the archway between them, the dappled shade of the courtyard showed, and the glitter and tinkle of the fountain.
The New Californian School, but built before that became so very fashionable, I should think, from the state of the gardens, which are beautiful even by Californian standards.
Cuban style, actually. But that's water from the same Spanish colonial well, Lou said.
It could have been the Casa Grande of a hacienda in any land where Spain's flag had once flown.
Papa wanted something that would make my mother feel at home.
His voice had a Groton School and Harvard Yard patrician accent of an East Coast variety, much like Uncle Teddy's. The black chamber was infested with recent Ivy League graduates of the more adventurous sort. And, of course, the president had been a Harvard man himself. They included a scattering of Bryn Mawr alumni like Luce, and a few from Wellesley and Smith and Vassar and the others. She'd been accepted as a field operative back in the chamber's beginnings, and the example had stuck. Things had been fluid then, despite which it had taken all her powers of persuasion and moral blackmail at the presidential level, and blunt, just shut up and make it happen orders from Uncle Teddy thereafter.
She laid out the gardens. The house had all the modern conveniences right from the start, though, and under the stucco, it's earthquake-proof. Cast mass concrete with galvanized steel reinforcing bars,
Ciara said impulsively.
One of the very earliest examples, with integral ducting for electrical lines and pipes.
She blushed and subsided, but Luz smiled at her and added,
That's it. Papa was a progressive long before the party. He knew the 20th century was coming soon.
Unlike some of my relatives, even now,
Chiney replied ruefully, hanging his hat on the mahogany rack,
for whom it's always the blessed eternal noon of 1899. Queen Victoria still alive. J.P. Morgan and J.D. Rockefeller allow the president to cut ribbons and kiss babies while they run the country. And all's well with the world.
The older generation of the upper 10,000 mostly thought Uncle Teddy a traitor to his class, a would-be Caesar Augustus, or both, and the whole new nationalist movement a grubby upstart affair of wild-eyed middle-class radicals. But plenty of younger scions like James had embraced the progressive Republican Party's new order. The strenuous life was much less boring than old-style politics had been, or sitting and biting your thumb in grumpy isolation like your parents while the world went elsewhere.
Do please step on through to the patio and join us, Mr. Chiney,
Ciara said carefully.
Watching her accent, too,
Luz thought, with a feeling of protective annoyance directed at the man, as they walked through the hallways and around the ascending glazed shells of the fountain. She knew it was irrational, since James was just talking in the way he did when he wasn't putting on something else. The plummy tones nevertheless activated Kira's hard-scrabble Boston Irish defensive hackles, and that made Luce bristle for her in turn. Ciara hadn't finished high school. Few people did. And even fewer girls and not particular affluent families who weren't aiming to be schoolteachers. But she had an excellent vocabulary, and her grammar was very good, since she'd grown up a voracious reader who lived above a bookstore. Her vowels did tend to be long and a bit nasal, though. She usually said, Boston, when she referred to her native town. And beneath it ran a brogue as green as a shamrock, and broad as her Dublin-born father's, that she could bring out when she wanted to, or that crept out under stress. China's blue-gray eyes flicked between them, and Luz saw him noting the identical robes they were wearing. Kira's instinctive half-step closer to Luz's side, and then the pledge rings, and mentally going,
Aha! I might have known. No, James, that wasn't the reason,
Luz said pleasantly, denying him the salve for his vanity.
It's just that I never liked you that much.
Ciara choked slightly as she realized that wasn't the reason, included an unspoken final phrase, why I wouldn't sleep with you. Flushed pink as she realized what China had picked up effortlessly about her, then coughed to cover it and the shocked giggle that might have followed. China held Kira's chair with gentlemanly politesse and waited for Luz to sit before taking another himself across the granite slab table beneath an arbor overgrown by queen's wreath and its long, drooping panicles of purple blossom. The gentle plashing of the fountain sounded in the background, and hummingbirds buzzed by.
"Coffee, Mr. China? Sugar? Cream?"
Kira asked.
"That's very kind of you, Miss Whelan, and I would love a cup. Black will do nicely. So sorry to have interrupted your luncheon."
Luz fought down a startled laugh of her own, with a strong but practiced effort of will that left her slight polite smile intact.
10 more minutes.
Kira poured, though with a very slight twitch at the same thought, and he took an appreciative sniff and sipped.
"Ah, thank you. Jamaica Blue Mountain, I think?"
Kira nodded.
"Deals Grocery in town stocks it, Mr. China. They have a very wide selection of coffees. Of everything, really."
"They should, in this sybaritic nest of plutocrats at play. Blue Mountain is my favorite. The very nectar of the gods, compared to the weak, burnt Harvey House muck from Brazil on the trains. Though I admit they serve a decent steak. If you stand over the cook with a pistol to his head to make sure it's done really rare. But that applies to restaurants all too often. Certainly to the one where I stopped for lunch."
"You had steak for lunch?" Lou said. "You're looking a little peaked, James, if you don't mind me saying so."
He'd always been leanly strong, and moved with the fluency that told an expert observer that he could be very fast indeed. But now he was slightly gaunt in the way you got if you were putting out everything you had and not eating all that well.
"I've been away from the land of the free and home of the sirloin. The steak helps, and the bacon-wrapped grilled oysters. I'm having steak 3 times a day for a while. Steak and eggs for breakfast today. Steak and potato au gratin for lunch at the Claremont here. And I'm planning on steak au poivre with frites for dinner, with a nice Zinfandel and a green salad and peach melba to follow at the Potter tonight. Besides, I hear Food Director Hoover is going to be decreeing meatless days for the war effort, and I'm doing my best before the dreaded nut cutlet arrives, smothered in scientifically enriched pureed green bean burgoo."
He went on with a wry smile.
"And here I see the inside of your beautiful home for the first time. And then you wound my sensitive, delicate feelings on the very doorstep, Luz. And I always thought we worked together so well. We saved each other's lives that time the Zaparistas inconsiderately overran the safe house at 3 in the morning. "Of course we did, James," she said.
A flash of memory went through her, her skin prickling a little at the visceral impact of it, though her face retained its calm. The darkened house in Cuautla, waking at a draft from the door opening. Air across skin, wet with the tropical heat of the Tierra Caliente. The smell alerting her as much as anything. Tobacco and marijuana and rank sweat soaked into coarse cotton, rarely washed. The distinctive body odor of men who worked in the hot sun of the cane fields and lived on corn tortillas and frijoles refritos and chilies and cheap flavored spirits, overlain with the musky harshness of anger and fear. And beyond that, fresh blood. Not very close, but somewhere in the house, and a lot of it. A board creaked under a hirachi sandal. Sliding out a hand and picking up the little FN automatic from the side table. Nothing else moving. Doing it smooth, fast, but without the jerk or grasp that might draw attention. She kept the pistol cocked at night and relied on the grip safety, and the door was only 12 feet away. Her black Chinese-style silk pajamas made the motion invisible in the dark, and they were perfect for action, which was why she didn't sleep naked or in a nightie anywhere she didn't consider very, very safe. Aiming was like pointing a finger, but the angle was awkward.
Patak, 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 patak!
The light 380 cartridges made a sharp sound, more like a little dog's shrill yapping than a bang, and the small, rounded weapon bucked in her hand. 5 shots at the half-seen black silhouette of a man outlined against the low, dim glimmer, like a target at a range. The corridor outside was open to the inner patio of the building on that side. Brief flashes showing red and giving grotesque strobing images. A bushy black mustache and a round brown face, eyes wide with shock, and black dots punched into the breastbone of his dingy off-white shirt. The second one tripping over the falling body as he tried to rush in behind the first, a hand thrown out for balance, gripping the hilt of a Morelos-style machete like a broad, point-heavy sword, and stumbling frantically forward trying to recover his footing so that the muzzle of the automatic was almost pressed to the bridge of his nose as their eyes met.
Patak, patak!
No time to reload, though she snatched up the spare magazine and stuffed it into a pocket while she flipped the gun into her left hand. A near shriek from the corridor.
Carlos, Miguel, también?
Strip the navaja out from under the pillow. Snap it open in the same motion. Out in the corridor, out from darkness into dimness, ducking smoothly down into a low crouch as she stepped toward the one who'd conveniently pinpointed himself by yelling, and who couldn't see a thing.
You can look from darkness into light, but not from light into darkness. Darkness is my old friend.
The third man's machete flashed over her head, a whisk of motion close enough to leave a tiny cooling draft on the back of her neck as she uncoiled forward and it banged into the plaster wall. Legs like springs pushing her up as she spun in a blur with the blade sweeping rightward, knowing in her gut and muscle where the neck had to be from glimpses and motions. Then, an instant's tug as the sharp steel ripped hard across taut skin and sliced deep, with the unmistakable crisp shearing feeling of striking the cartilage of a windpipe, like cutting through a cardboard tube. An incredulous, choked, gurgling grunt followed it, and salty drops landing across her face.
Carlos y Miguel están jodidos. Igual que tú, cabrón,
she snarled under her breath in belated answer to his question, as relief washed over her skin like stepping into a warm bath. She continued the spin until she was facing back toward the stairwell at the end of the corridor, and the graceful spray of blood from the Toledo blade was liquid geometry for an instant on the pale stucco of the wall, where it had followed the curve of the arrabato cut to the jugular. The body thumping to the tiles behind her, amid that hot, salt, iodine stink that was like seawater and meat. A rustle through the leaves of the banana trees in the courtyard, and the scent of night jasmine under the blood and powder gas. And slurred peasant voices on the stair ahead of her, shrieking,
Viva Zapata! Muerte a la Cámara Negra! Viva me!
China burst out of his own room, mother naked and barefoot. 2 steps and he was at the head of the stairs in the classic edge-on stance, with his left hand down by his side, holding 2 spare magazines and the big Colt automatic in his outstretched right.
Crack!
And a half-second pause as he brought it back down to firing position. Then, 6 more at the same metronome intervals.
Crack! 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 Crack!
Stunning loud as he emptied the weapon, using the crimson stab of each muzzle flash to aim the next shot. The attackers were trying to do this quietly to get in and out before a reaction force from the garrison arrived. But for the Americans, the more noise the better. flashes of light on the white eyes and teeth and the honed edges of the machetes as the campesino guerrillas stormed upward to kill the hated gringo spies. He'd started with a man in the rear and then moved his aim forward in a ripple of death so that the leaders would think he was missing and not stop or take time to think about shooting instead of chopping. 7 shots for 8 men. 7 massive 230-grain chunks of lead moving 1,000 feet a second as the shooter grinned like a death's head. The second to last had fallen backward from 6 feet away as the .45 slug put a blue hole in the top of his forehead and exited in a gout of bone fragments and gluey pink brain and blood that was red-black in the dimness. That left the one in the lead, raising his machete with a shriek of rage. Luz had snaked her left hand around James's body. Patak! A flutter of cloth as she fired close enough that the muzzle blast singed the machetero's long cotton shirt. He started to fold as the bullet hit in the pit of his stomach, and then he flipped backward in a cracking tumble all the way to the bottom of the stone staircase as China kicked him in the face with his heel. Then they'd leapt down from stair to stair, careful to avoid the bodies, some still sprattling like pithed frogs from the headshots. They reloaded on the move. She'd had the knife in her teeth as she did, and the blood had tasted as metallic as the steel. Luz shook her head as she returned across years and miles to the house her parents had built. When she spoke, her voice was light.
"And we picked leeches off each other's backs in that pinche selva in Quintana Roo, James. I have the highest professional regard for you, mi camarada. Professional, because there's also the fact that you're a bit of a bully sometimes when you get the chance,"
Luz thought behind her smile. Secret agent work tended to attract the type, for some reason. There were women who found that attractive, though not as many as men thought. And it wasn't a fantasy she'd ever had the slightest interest in accommodating.
"I actually do quite like you, James. Just not as much or in the way you think as you're due."
"No accounting for tastes," he said. "I understand from catching up on the chamber rumor mill that professional congratulations are in order for your promotion. And to both you ladies for a job well done. Whatever the job was. Getting the Corona Obsidianalis without dying. Not many have managed that."
"Precisely two," Luz corrected. "Us.
True. And without even being crippled for life first. No details, I don't need to know. But add my envious congratulations to the pile for what they're worth."
"Thank you. Yes, the mission did go rather well,"
she said, and gave Ciara a fond glance and half wink.
"Though Miss Whelan and I ended up saving each other's lives any number of times."
China had almost certainly figured out that they'd been involved in foiling the horror gas plot somehow, since nobody had ever said he was a fool, and there weren't many alternative explanations. But what wasn't explicitly said didn't have to be acknowledged or denied. Silence could be a wonderful thing, both tool and weapon.
"And you've been where, James?"
"Congratulating myself of late on being among the non-decomposing minority of humankind," he said, non-specifically.
There was a newish purple scar on the back of his right hand. It looked very much like the Cyrillic letter Sha, cut in with a knife, which would stand for the initial S in Shpion, the Russian word for spy.
"You had a bad time in Russia?" she said,
and added,
"If that's not a redundant adjective these days."
The Tsar's inept Ruritanian autocracy had started its circling swirl around the porcelain bowl at Tannenberg and the Masurian Lakes in August 1914, when the Great War was young, and where Generals Hindenburg and Ludendorff had made their names while obliterating two invading Russian armies. Then, last year, more armies, millions strong, had vanished into the iron jaws of the German Kesselschlachten, one after another, at obscure hamlets whose names were now written on history in letters of fire and blood. Gorlich Tarnow and Grodno, Bialystok and Brest-Litovsk. This summer and fall had seen the final gurgling flush of collapse, abdication, and abject surrender to the status of German puppet, with the ex-Tsar's first cousin once removed, Grand Duke Nikolai, as theoretical regent for the sickly Tsarevich, an actual glove on Ludendorff's iron Prussian fist.
"Right in one, Luz," China said, and rubbed carefully at the healing wound. "It must have been strenuous."
"It's even worse there now than the papers say," he said, and added, "You never did miss much."
"Russian is one of your languages, and with that scar, not much doubt about which particular pot of boiling sewage the director dropped you in."
"Yes, I'm going to have some cosmetic work done on this," he said, touching the back of his hand. Luz nodded with cheerful ruthlessness.
"The chamber should get something out of the surgeons we keep on retainer."
China snorted. "When I finished what I was doing," she would have been shocked if he'd been more specific, "I made it out of Moscow just before Colonel Nikolai's men—" Ciara stiffened for a moment at the mention of the name of the head of Abteilung 3B, then relaxed as Luz touched her on the shoulder briefly and gently. There was nothing like that knife-edged thread of death and torture to make memory stand out with cut crystal clarity afterward, and the feelings came back with the images.
"That can be bad," Luz thought. "It's worse when they come back in your dreams."
"Arrived to extract my name from the Okhrana, and then extract my toenails to make me talkative. I jumped onto the very last through train on the Trans-Siberian before they stopped even trying to run them, which was a relief."
He rubbed the scar again.
"Only then Baron von Ungern Sternberg's cavalry hijacked the train east of Lake Baikal in the name of the new Yeke Kagan of Greater Mongolia, and gave me this when they realized I wasn't Russian."
"Ungern Sternberg? Is that a Russian name, Mr. China?"
Ciara asked. She sounded a little more sympathetic now, probably because of the reminder of their common enemy.
"It sounds more German."
"It was German. A very long time ago, Miss Whelan, in the Crusades against the Baltic heathen. A lot of officers in the Russian army are from the Baltic German nobility. Von Ungern Sternberg was, until he decided he'd rather be a bloody-handed Mongolian warlord. A fair number of troops followed him when the Russian army collapsed, and he decided to take over Mongolia with them, chase out the Chinese, and declare himself Ka Khan. And he's become a very odd variety of Buddhist."
"Odd?" Luz said.
She knew a little about Soto Zen, but not much of the faith in general, except that it had even more distinct flavors than Christianity did, which was saying something. "As in reincarnation of Genghis Khan and avatar of the war goddess Famsaran. And he's quite sincere, too."
"He must be crazy," Ciara blurted.
"Mad as a hatter, Miss Whelan. And looks it. A demented stare, with one bulging eye bigger than the other. And his face twitches, and this damned great scar on his forehead flashes purple just before he starts the random killing. Well, usually there's burning and flaying and impaling first."
Luce's brows went up at something she caught between his casual tone of ironic amusement. She'd learned by personal experience that China had strong nerves, even by the chamber's exacting standards. But if you knew him well, He sounded a little
disturbed. This bloody baron must be very bloody indeed.
He has a whole carnival freak show of desperados and lunatics, and assorted maniacal butchering horrors in his train, complete with heads on spears, and necklaces of ears and teeth, and drinking fermented mare's milk out of cups made from human skulls, lined with gold. I suspected they had more of the ever-popular game of Carve the Yankee in mind.
Or possibly a new skull goblet. What's fermented mare's milk like?
Lou said. Vile, as you'd expect. But not quite as vile as you would expect. So I abjured their hospitality, stole a string of mongrel ponies, and made my way east. Then I got out of Vladivostok on a Peruvian-flagged freighter bound for the U.S., just moments before our new and dearly beloved Japanese allies in the struggle against the evils of Prussian militarism arrived with their Toko Kempeitai.
Special Secret Section of the Japanese Military Police,
Luce translated for Kira.
They do what we do, more or less. A very unpleasant lot.
She turned to China.
Under our great and good new friend, General Akashi Motojiro?
I heard rumors to the effect it was to be that very same nasty and far too clever piece of work, with Sado Araki and the Black Dragon Society in tow, China said. Luce nodded. The Black Dragons were a secret society of fanatics who believed Japan destined to rule all East Asia and operated through propaganda, subversion, and assassination. Araki was one of Japan's best secret agents and had a network of spies and sympathizers that stretched all the way to Central Asia. China went on.
Since what's left of Russia is a German puppet these days, we can't even really object to the Japanese taking it over. And they'll keep going until they and the Germans meet up somewhere around Lake Baikal in Siberia, is my guess. Akashi is their best Russian specialist, Luce clarified for Kira. He's half the reason Russia had a revolution in 1905, while they were fighting Japan.
Kira frowned.
I thought that was because the Japanese sank their navy and beat the stuffing out of their army.
That was the other half, Miss Whelan, China said with a raised eyebrow with a naive but acute analysis. I was sure Rikugan Shosho Akashi would be just as glad as Herr Oberst Nikolai to have a long, friendly chat with me. But luckily, my humble, rusty, wheezing, guano-scented but beautiful Santa Rosa de Lima escaped attention as we sailed out past a gigantic convoy of Japanese troop transports and warships, impressively inbound, and headed by Fuso and Yamashiro.
Their latest big battleships, Kira said,
with an absent-minded look that Luce knew marked her consulting the reference library in her head.
Just under 30,000 tons displacement. Brown Curtis direct-drive steam turbines. Water tube boilers. Mixed oil-coal firing. 40,000 shaft horsepower. 23 knots. They must have hurried Yamashiro through her sea trials.
Yes, Miss Whelan, China said, with a well-hidden look of surprise. Luce didn't bother to hide a smile or her pride. Kira wasn't particularly interested in warships as such. Big, complex modern machines with turbines, on the other hand.
That sounds like the sort of close call that's much more fun in retrospect, Luce said, because then you know how it turned out.
China nodded.
There was already panic in Vladivostok, not to mention drunken despair, arson, looting and rioting, and stampedes trying to get on departing ships. A bit of the strenuous life, and no mistake. Not that I blame the locals for being a trifle put out at the change of management. They know the Nips well in that part of the world, and the Ruski love the little yellow devils not. A feeling which is very much mutual. It all sounds very exciting,
Mr. China, Ciara said. Luz glanced at China and pursed her mouth slightly. In their line of work, exciting also meant something had gone spectacularly wrong, since ideally the enemy never knew what you'd found out, until what they didn't know about what you did know about them hurt them very badly.
Which ideal Ciara and I just about brought off, except for the very last bit in Boston, and that was too late to do the Germans any good. Though James does seem to have recovered with style.
It also sounded very much as if relations between the United States and the Dai Nippon Taikoku were going into the toilet too, rounding out the round world's agonies as the Great War spread like cancer, or filaments of mold in bread. If you knew how to look between the lines.
Our very nominal new allies in Tokyo are going to grab with both hands while the grabbing is good, and the Western powers are wrecked or fighting for bare survival, she thought.
They'd already taken over the Dutch East Indies and French Indochina, theoretically, very theoretically, to keep the Germans out.
And now we can't stop them putting the knuckle on China either, the way we did when they tried with their 21 demands last year, either.
It didn't surprise her, and this certainly wasn't one of the very rare occasions she felt moral outrage, either. Empires were empires, and people were people, and they both did what they did. Getting your knickers in a twist about it put you on the wrong side of the way she did usually divide the world, apart from the obvious eternal and elemental one of us and them, and cutting across it, not into good or bad, but into smart people on the one hand, and on the other,
fools. But on a personal level, I really must get the whole Taguchi family on the protected contact list without delay, just in case. It could get unpleasant here for people with Japanese names if things go badly toes up. Even with that cabron, William also ran Dolph Hurst, the Wizard of Ooze, retired to his ranch.
In 1907, the boss had called Hurst the most potent influence for evil in American life, and their long-standing mutual loathing had gone even further downhill from there. The last straw driving El Jefe into one of his rare but impressive rages had been an editorial comparing the American troops in Mexico to the Germans in Belgium, and hoping the Revolucionario guerrillas would drive them out. The subsequent visit to Mr. Hurst by the chamber had included James Chiney to do the talking, and one Luz O'Malley Rostegui being persuasive by standing in the background, smiling a sinister Latin smile, and rolling her open navaja across her knuckles. When he'd blustered about whether the president had authorized this outrage, she'd smiled again and said softly, glancing down at the moving glitter on the edge of the Toledo steel,
"Not in so many words, Mr. Hurst, but there was something that, with enough deliberate ill will, might have been interpreted as, 'Will no one rid me of this meddlesome priest?'"
At which Hurst looked as if he'd bitten into a lemon, not fancying Thomas Becket's martyr's crown one little bit. James had raised a patrician eyebrow and quoted the chamber's unofficial motto,
"Non teodorum parvis, concitares ne perturbatus sit."
Then he'd smiled with genial, cruel contempt and added,
"You are a detail, sir, and one way or another, you will cease to bother."
That had finally pierced the narcissist's armor, with the realization that the rules had well and truly changed. Whereupon Hurst had decided to lead a quiet rural life on his enormous coastal ranch near Paso Robles, and sold his papers at quite fair prices to designated buyers to finance a mansion and art collection there. These days, those rags weren't indulging in their former specialty of trying to whip up feeling against Japanese immigrants and Orientals in general, or against the party and Uncle Teddy.
or the intervention policy in Mexico, or in favor of Germany, or spreading atrocity stories recycled from the Philippine insurrection days, either.
"Better you than me when it comes to last-minute escapes, James,"
she said aloud, and wrote a brief note on a pad.
"Hand this on to Station Chief Reiter when you get back to San Francisco, would you? And tell him I need a minor favor from him, sub rosa. I want those people put on the shelter list, just in case."
Reiter would normally do any valued operative a small favor like this as a matter of courtesy, as long as it wasn't countermission or financially smelly, and still more so for her, now that she was in the director's extremely good graces. And he'd be able to call on her for some equally moderate return in the future. Luz prided herself on never forgetting a debt, for good or ill. As a bonus, Ciara smiled with delight when she realized what Luz meant. "Certainly," China said, glancing at the note before putting it into one of his waistcoat/pockets. "Friends of yours?"
"Yes, personally, and old family friends, too. There are debts of honor involved."
"I don't think the boss or the rest of the party leadership will let the state government go too far, unless there's actual war with Japan. And that won't happen soon, if ever. Teddy admires the Nips because they're hard workers and tough fighters. And clever little devils, too. And because they're disciplined enough to make Prussians look like anarchists."
"He thinks the ones we have here are national assets," Luz agreed. "But not everybody's as sensible as El Jefe. And the elder Taguchis are still Japanese subjects, which might matter, though their children are American citizens, of course. You Easterners don't appreciate how strong that feeling is on this coast."
"I do remember how El Jefe had to take the mayor of San Francisco to the White House woodshed in 07 and give him a sound spanking over trying to force Japanese children out of the local schools.
That whole idiotic episode cost us goodwill with Japan. We'll have to pay for with blood someday,"
Luz said grimly.
"I can't stop the California state legislature from being hysterical buffoons, but I can hold out an umbrella for a few people if it starts to rain stupid."
"I'll ask Reiter to get right on it."
"Gracias, James."
"Think nothing of it."
"We'll pay you back with a Hangtown fried dinner and a bottle of Inglenook at the Tarich Grill next time we're all in Fogtown at once, while you entertain us with the grisly gothic details of your trabajos patrióticos in Outer Mongolia."
It was all epically hellish and bloody cold even a few weeks ago. And my getting out was an epic, too, of dash and grit and good old Yankee ingenuity. What a pity the report will languish in the Class A secret files. Unless Teddy reads it for a little light entertainment. Luz chuckled.
"He does do that. You know he does. Says it has Richard Harding Davis's adventure stories beat all hollow. Or even this new English author he's so fond of, Buchan. You know, Prester John and the 39 Steps."
"John Buchan," China said, and surprised her a little by laying a finger beside his nose. "Just between me and thee, Buchan actually is in British intelligence now. Military intelligence. If he's still alive, that is. He was on Haig's staff in France when I met him for a little quiet liaison work back in the spring, when we were still neutral, officially, and before everything went to hell. Haig is dead, by the way."
"The horror gas got him when they shelled his HQ?"
Luz asked, and China nodded. "Plummer has his job now, poor chap. Talk about inheriting a poison chalice."
"You'd never know Buchan's really in the trade from his books," Luz said. "Outrageous coincidences, como pulgas sobre un perro."
"I wouldn't know about either the fleas on the dog or the coincidences in the books," China said loftily. Speaking Spanish well was a common accomplishment in the chamber. "I never read that pulp trash myself.
Liar, Luz said amiably.
Spy, China replied with a shrug.
Glad you agree with my analysis of your character, James. And I think Uncle Teddy likes to imagine himself a dashing secret agent, dear Slobendiga. But then, as Alice put it, he'd like to be the bride at every wedding, the corpse at every funeral, and the baby at every christening.
China barked a startled laugh.
Did she? Tongue like a viper, that girl. You can get away with it if you're the president's eldest.
And if it's true enough to cut. Luz nodded agreement.
Speaking of weddings, did I ever tell you my parents and I were at his niece Eleanor's wedding to her cousin Franklin? Fifth cousin, wasn't it? You were at Groton School with him, I think.
Franklin Delano Roosevelt of the Hyde Park Roosevelts? Yes, though only as a lowly first-year dirt beneath his exalted senior-year feet. I missed the wedding, but the papers were all over it because of Teddy. They hardly mentioned the bride, and Franklin only in passing. I think he's doing something administrative in the Navy Department now, and he and Eleanor have a swarm of little Roosevelts, which must put that prig Davenport in seventh heaven. Dr. Charles Benedict Davenport, secretary of the new Department of Public Health and Eugenics, was indeed a frigid, ruthless, fanatic prig of a man. Not too different from his long line of Calvinistic Puritan ancestors, if you substituted genetic defectives for sinners and witches.
What was the wedding like? China added with interest. Apart from the ancient order of inebriated Hibernians.
Kira chuckled, though she might not have if Luz hadn't been Catholic and surnamed O'Malley.
Bellowing the wearing of the green outside because it was St. Patrick's Eve? The wedding was a very genteel political rally. Teddy gave her away, slapped the groom on the back after the kiss the bride, boomed out a hearty, "Well, Franklin, there's nothing like keeping the name in the family, with every tooth showing in that grin of his," and made a beeline for the dining room and the buffet, with Aunt Edith sighing and rolling her eyes in his wake.
China grinned,
and all the guests followed him, like ducklings waddling after their mamacita, leaving Franklin and Eleanor standing there alone, listening to the crowd laughing at his stories in the other room.
"Oh, poor Franklin," China said, with an unsympathetic chuckle.
"El Jefe didn't mean any harm by it, but I stayed with them for a bit anyway."
Out of the corner of her eye, she saw Kira giving her a nod and a slow smile for the minor kindness. Luz felt a slight stab of guilt at taking the credit. She'd done it out of vicarious embarrassment for Teddy and Edith, whom she adored, as much as anything. Your elders embarrassed you so easily when you were 14. And her father had just said that if he'd followed the colonel up San Juan Hill, he wasn't going to object to following him to the punch bowl. China slapped a hand on the table in delight.
"That's the boss, all right. He'd be a complete blowhard and jackass if it weren't that every bit of it is the real thing, in spades and all the way down.
And he'll enjoy my report, full of manly, masterly understatement about my exploits. Though I was sorely tempted to throw in a knife fight with a snow leopard in a Mongolian forest, just for him." Luz and China both laughed aloud at that. On a hunt in 1901, Roosevelt had famously leapt on a cougar and stabbed it to death.
"So, you can see the temptation to throw a huge evil cat into my report, Miss Whelan," he said. "And then, alas, sans hand-to-hand battle with a leopard in a snowbank." "Cliff, James," Luz interrupted. "You could have rolled off a cliff into a snowbank, locked in a death grapple with the beast, and torn its throat out with my teeth, broken its neck with a full Nelson,
the way Burroughs' Wild Man does to African lions. And then, in prose rather than poetry, I debriefed at the San Francisco station, and Reiter gave me this paperwork from HQ for you, Luz. He added a verbal message from the director that he's sorry to interrupt the vacation, but it's time you two got the standard reward for good work. Luz laughed again, without much humor this time, and added to Ciara, "The reward for good work is more work, of course." China nodded. "I expect to go right back into the soup myself, with a bandage on my hand. We're stretched a bit thin, and San Francisco was a madhouse. Everyone running around waving handfuls of paper in the air and talking on the telephone at the same time. You and the fair Miss Whelan must have really shown to get this much of a holiday." "Like diamonds in the noonday sun, James," she said, and winked at Ciara. "Like onyx and gold." He put the attaché case on the table, where it thunked on the stone surface with an authority that revealed the lining of armor-grade alloy steel plate, and worked the little inset combination lock before snapping the catches. Inside was a shortened Colt 45 automatic pistol and a concealed integral holster that made it very convenient for drawing and shooting someone who was forcing you to open the case and thought you'd been disarmed, and a thick set of heavy, legal-sized envelopes sealed with cord and wax, and nothing on their outside except letter-number combinations. China handed Luz one of two identical lists, and they ceremoniously checked them and exchanged signatures that the envelopes had been delivered, listing their numbers and attesting that they were fully sealed at the time of transfer. Most of them felt as if they held briefing files, false passports, and similar tools of the trade. But one, she felt her brows rise as Ciara solemnly signed for one of the lighter ones herself.
"This is for you, Ciara," she said, and handed it to her.
Ciara opened it, and her rather broad mouth turned into an O of surprise as she read the letter inside.
"Oh, my goodness,"
she said excitedly, in what was almost a breathy squeal.
"Tesla agrees with me. The thing I saw on the big ships in... No, no."
The words blurred as China's voice overlapped with Luz's, saying the same thing.
"I don't need to know, Miss Whelan," he said, smiling to take the sting out of it. "And therefore, I shouldn't. Particularly if the mad god of the technical section is involved. Believe me, that's best all round."
"He always did have good manners, most of the time," Luz thought,
as he clicked the attaché case shut and gave a half bow to them both.
"Good afternoon, Luz. Miss Whelan." "I'll see myself out," he said.
Ciara waited until she heard the door close.
"Luz," she said, "leeches? On your back?"
3. American National Railways Coastal Express, Southern California, November 19, 1916 B.
"Saints, what's that?"
Ciara said. Or literally,
"Por los santos, ¿qué es eso?"
Their prospective cover identities in Europe were Spanish-speaking until they got to Germany, and it was never too early for Ciara to practice the language. Luz stretched, yawned with a hand over her mouth, and put aside a newspaper with yet another article on Canada. The very orphan Dominion's very shell-shocked parliament had reacted to the destruction of London by voting to join the United States last week, each province, plus Newfoundland, to be a state, with the unhappy but sincere approbation of Lord Protector Milner over in Britain. Instead of reading more, there was an interesting article in the Times on how former Princess Mary, the sole survivor of her family due to a lucky visit to Bristol, and now Queen Empress Victoria,
was planning an indefinite stay in New Delhi, she turned her eyes out the compartment window to follow Kira's finger as the Coastal Express halted at one of the level crossings that had survived the rebuilding so far.
"Por todos los santos,"
she corrected automatically as she did. Luz had ridden this line from Santa Barbara to Los Angeles all her life, and the stuffy warmth had made her drowsy, despite the new build smell of paint and varnish in this side corridor compartment car. Fresh air came through a narrow crack of open window, with the oily petroleum stink of the locomotive smoke, though that was a lot better than the hot cinders and clinging, smeary soot of the old coal burners that were now rare west of the Rockies. The younger woman hadn't traveled much at all until recently, though. This time, what Ciara was staring at with bright-eyed wonder was another train sitting on a siding next to the main track. There were five heavy-duty 50x10 flat cars behind the big new 484 ANR Goliath-class superheated fast freight loco, followed by an ordinary freight wagon and then a passenger car on the caboose. Four of the flat cars had identical rectangular somethings under tied-down tarpaulins of army drab, which meant a military cargo, and the somethings were themselves chained to the frame of the flatbeds with massive links held tight by eyebolts.
"Those must be armored cars. Lynx battle autos,"
Luz began, and stopped as she realized she was wrong. The silhouettes under the canvas didn't look quite right. And an ANR flat car like the ones in this train could hold two lynxes. And they wouldn't put covers on them. Successive models had been around for a couple of years now and weren't any sort of secret. There were thousands of them, and they featured in parades often enough. The fifth flat car had the same thing with the tarpaulin peeled back, and a group of wrench-wielding men in blue, almost black, military fatigue overalls were swarming around an open compartment in the rear of...
"No, that's definitely not a lynx," Luz said,
keenly interested herself now. Whatever it was had the same general sort of slab-sided angular hull of riveted armor plate as the American cavalry's standard war auto, liberally splashed with mud, as you usually saw them when they weren't inches deep in khaki-colored Mexican dust. The unit insignia was familiar, too. The 2nd Cavalry's palmetto leaf, an 8-pointed shield, with Toujours Prêt blazoned on it. But it had the eye-baffling quality of something new. It was bigger, with what looked like a 6-pounder cannon, rather than a pom-pom in the turret besides a machine gun. And instead of having three evenly spaced rubber wheels 4 feet high on each side, like the Lynx armored war autos she'd seen so often, this had six much smaller metal wheels in pairs resting on...
"That's endless metal treads, like a whole tractor," Ciara said. "I saw an article on them in a copy of American Mechanical Engineer I picked up a few years ago, while I was helping Colm at the machine shop where he was working. I'd bring him his dinner from home, and then work on the lathe while he was eating. A Holt crawler. Aye, now I see."
Her mind snapped the pieces together. Luz had seen Holt crawler tractors in the Delta country west of Sacramento, where they were used on the deep, soft soils reclaimed from the marshy islands. And on major construction projects the last couple of years, too, like the Colorado Valley Authority dams and canals, or the huge road program and the Yaqui Valley irrigation settlements down in the protectorate.
"Caterpillar treads, they're called. A belt to reduce the ground pressure," Ciara said. "The power is transmitted with that sprocket at the rear, and the driver sits at the front. See the little folding windows and slits in the steel? So, they've taken an armored battle car, made it bigger, and put it on top of a Holt crawler tractor. Though the Holts don't have those little wheels and the things they're attached to. The ones painted on the... what's the Spanish word for suspension? Suspension. And they're connected to the body by that bell crank and the horizontal volute spring, see? What's that in Spanish?
Luz opened her mouth, hesitated, and thought for a moment before she spoke.
Ah, springs are mueles. Horizontal is horizontalis, of course. Volute. That sounds like a Latin loan in English, so it's probably voluta or something like it. Bell crank. I think that's palanca acordada. Se suspension con mueles de voluta horizontales y una palanca acordada? A Spanish speaker would certainly understand it, but I've no idea if a Spanish-speaking engineer would use the phrase just that way, or if there is a phrase for that in Spanish, yet. That's the first time you've had problems with a translation.
I didn't. It's not my Spanish that's the problem. It's my engineerish. I couldn't have come up with that in English either, not to save my life.
Fortunately, I have an expert with me.
Ciara repeated the Spanish phrase to fix it in her memory, then continued.
The springs and cranks would be to help reduce battering at higher speeds. Old tractors don't go faster than walking pace, so they don't need it.
But how clever it all is. They've put together a lot of known things into something that's just new. How very, very clever.
Luz blinked. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.